Welcome back to Simply Sakura, my friends. I hope you are all doing well today. My name is Gary Sakura, and this is my MotoVlog and True Crime Stories. I simply drive around on my motorbike, and I tell true crime and unsolved mystery stories. If you are new here, welcome, and I am so glad that you decided to stop by. Do you love true crime or unsolved mysteries while enjoying a different, unique type of a MotoVlog? Then I suggest that you hit that subscribe button down below so you don't miss out on any of my future true crime stories. Today, we are going to talk about another unsolved mystery. Once again, I will begin by telling the story, and then I will present any case file theories that I find suitable for this particular case. Our unsolved case file today is the strange disappearance of Leah Roberts. With that, let's dive right in. Leah Toby Roberts was born in 1976 and raised in the suburbs of Durham, North Carolina. Like most kids, Leah had a typical childhood. Unfortunately, things took a turn for the worse when she was in her teens. When Leah was 17 years old, her father was diagnosed with a chronic lung illness, which had a big impact on the family. In 1995, when Leah, 20 years old at the time, was a sophomore at North Carolina University, her mother sadly passed away with an undetected heart disease. Leah took the death of her mother extremely hard. Leah took a break from studying to deal with her own grief at losing her mother at such a young age. She returned in the fall of 1998. Not long after returning to the university, Leah was involved in a serious car accident when a truck turned in front of her and she could not brake in time to avoid slamming into it. Leah was severely injured in the crash, which resulted in a punctured lung and a shattering of her right femur. Her leg was so badly damaged in the accident that surgeons had to place a metal rod alongside her thigh bone so it would heal properly. It was this accident that gave Leah a different perspective on life. She told her sister Kara that she thought that she was going to die, and to have survived such a horrific accident, she felt that she had been reborn. She did not want to waste another moment of her life when it could be snatched away from her again in an instant. Around 6 months later, in the spring of 1999, Leah's dad died. Leah's friends and family did, however, noticed a change in her personality and behavior. Leah began to withdraw from close friends and family members. Although she was only a semester away from graduating college, Leah decided to leave school so she could live life to the fullest. Leah had money from her inheritance left from her parents. She purchased a guitar. She began to take lessons. She also began showing a keen interest in photography and in writing. She would spend numerous amount of times in local coffee shops where she would interact with other patrons, writing poetry and journaling about the meaning of life. On the morning of March 9th, 2000, Leah spoke to her sister Kara on the phone. She had also spoken to Nicole about babysitting the following day. Well, later that evening, when Nicole headed out, she noticed that Leah packed up all her clothing and other personal items, and then she took her white Jeep Cherokee. Kara had visited stores and coffee shops where she knew her sister visited frequently to see if that anyone knew where Leah may have gone. Kara was unable to locate anyone that may have given her an indication into where Leah may have gone. Sakura thought, well, perhaps Leah just took a trip to find herself and to deal with the internal pain of losing both her parents and almost losing her own life. On Monday, March 13th, Nicole reached out to Leah's sister, Cara, and explained that Leah had just simply vanished. So Cara called the Durham police to report Leah missing. Leah, unfortunately, has never been seen or heard from again. Which brings us to our first case file theory. Did Leah simply just take a spontaneous trip? When searching her sister's room, Cara came across a few cryptic notes and a drawing of Chester the cat from Alice in Wonderland. Leah loved the movie Alice in Wonderland, and Cara thought the drawing was somewhat significant as the cat would disappear and reappear. Wrapped in the note, Leah left enough cash to cover approximately a month of rent and utilities. The money, the items missing from the house, and the content of the note led Leah's loved ones to believe that she had just simply gone on a trip, but was planning on returning. Following the discovery of the money, Cara felt Leah had planned to leave on a trip and had just simply left on her own accord. Given that there was only a month's worth of expenses left for Nicole, Cara felt Leah would plan to return in a month. Cara also had a power of attorney over her sister's bank, so she decided to check to see if Leah had simply used her debit card. On the afternoon of March 9th, just after she was last seen by her roommate, Leah withdrew several thousand dollars from her bank account. It was confirmed through Leah's debit card usage that she was traveling. Cara could see in Leah's bank statements that her debit card was being used to pay for a motel room and numerous of other transactions for gas and food, which helped Cara to trace her sister's movements across the country. Leah's final debit card payment showed her purchasing gas in Brooks, Oregon on March 13th. Which brings us to our second case file theory. Did Leah die as a result of a car accident? On March 18th, 2000, Cara hoped her sister would call for her to wish her a happy birthday, but she never heard anything. Instead, she arrived home to find a note from the Durham County Sheriff's Department requesting that Cara call Whatcom County Sheriff in Billingham, Washington. Earlier that day, joggers had located a Jeep Cherokee that had been discovered. It was abandoned and smashed up on the side of the road 30 miles east of Billingham, Washington. During their run, the joggers noticed that there were clothes scattered throughout the wilderness, and they had grown curious to where all this clothing came from. The clothing was found at a sharp curve in the road, leading to an upward incline. Oftentimes, locating a missing person's vehicle results in a break in the case. But initially, evidence in and around Leah's Jeep painted quite a confusing picture for the investigators. Leah's passport, checkbook, credit card, debit card, driver's license, clothing, guitar, and other personal items were tossed around in the Jeep and on the ground in the surrounding area. $2,500 in cash was discovered in the pocket of a pair of pants. Under a floor mat, investigators found Leah's mother's engagement ring. It was a piece of jewelry Leah's loved ones said that Leah cherished and would never willingly ever leave behind. Crime scene investigators determined that the vehicle was moving around 40 miles an hour. They determined this by surveying the damage to the trees and the ground in the surrounding area, as well as the dents and smashed out windows of the Jeep. The investigators estimated the vehicle had rolled down the embankment before coming to a stop at the bottom. something wasn't adding up with the accident. Based on the amount of damage to the vehicle, there was no possible way someone could physically walk away from the vehicle. There were no tracks found or any sign of anyone outside of the scattered items of clothing. Oh, yet it appeared as though the driver was uninjured in the accident because no blood was found in the Jeep and the windshield was cracked and broken, but there was no obvious impact mark where a head had hit it. And the driver's side seatbelt was not stretched from apparently stopping a body from being propelled forward during a normal crash. Police wondered if somehow the accident was all staged. They thought that the Jeep could have been purposely crashed through an occupant inside, but at the time there was no solid evidence demonstrating how this could have ever been done. Even more perplexing was the discovery of blankets and pillows hanging across the Jeep's windows, suggesting someone used the vehicle as a shelter after the crash. Investigators thought Leah may have been injured in the accident and then wandered off into the woods. They spent 2 weeks combing the area for the missing woman with a search and rescue team, dogs, and helicopters, but they never found any trace of Leah. Which brings us to our third case file theory. What about foul play? The discovery of the money and the ring led police to believe that Leah may have become a victim of foul play, in which robbery did not seem to be the motive. The police found one piece of significant evidence to help establish a timeline. There was a memory box inside the Jeep, which had a movie ticket stub dated 13 March 2000. It was for the 2:10 p.m. showing of The American Beauty at the Bellis Fair Mall in Billingham, Washington. This meant Leah would have arrived in Billingham at least 5 days before her Jeep had been discovered. There was no evidence Leah had stayed in a hotel during this time, which could be the reason why her Jeep windows were covered with blankets and pillows. Kara flew to Billingham to search for her sister. Kara went to the Bellis Fair Mall and she just simply went around asking shopkeepers if they recalled seeing her sister Leah. She was pretty sure Leah would have grabbed a bite to eat before or even after the movie. Kara homed in on the mall's only sit-down restaurant. It looked just like the spot Leah would eat at. After talking with the employee, she was completely right. Leah had been at the restaurant on the day she went to the movies. Police then became involved and were directed to two male customers who had been sitting on either side of Leah at the main counter. While they ate, they made small talk. Leah shared with them why she was going to the Pacific Northwest on a journey of self-discovery. One of the men said Leah had left with a customer named Barry. He even provided enough of a description that police had a composite sketch made. Here is the composite sketch of what Barry would look like. This mysterious Barry was never found, and so Leah's case went cold. In 2006, the lead detective retired, and Leah's case had changed hands. After reviewing the files, the new detectives realized Leah's Jeep and its contents have never been fully processed. They decided to go through an inspection of the vehicle to see if they could turn up anything. The detectives started by looking under the hood, and lo and behold, they found a fingerprint underneath the hood, and they also found male DNA, which was discovered on some of Leah's clothing, using newer technology that had not been previously available. Right away, detectives suspected the man from the restaurant was involved, the one who was most certain Leah had left with a man named Barry, but no one else recalled seeing this guy. Investigators had to wait over 2 years to find out if their suspicions were right. It was a lengthy process to get his fingerprints and DNA because the suspect had moved to Canada sometime after Leah had vanished. When the evidence collection was finally completed, his fingerprints did not match the ones found under the hood of the Jeep, although it has never been reported if the DNA evidence was an actual match. But it's probably safe to say that there was never an arrest ever made. What do you think happened to Leah? Although no new evidence has been found for many years, Leah's loved ones continue their quest for answers. They continue to hold out, hoping that one day Leah will come back home. Anyway, this concludes today's MotoVlog and True Crime Stories with Simply Sakura. I do hope you found this story interesting. There are plenty more MotoVlog and True Crime Stories coming very soon. Thanks so much for hanging out with me today. And if you have any comments or you'd like to add a case file theory of your own, I highly encourage that you leave them down below. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you soon. Alright, we're at a red light, so you know what that means, right? It's time for some jokes to close out this week's MotoVlog and True Crime Stories. What's the best thing about Switzerland? I don't know, but their flag is a huge plus. What? You didn't like that one? I'm just starting to warm up. What do you call a Frenchman wearing sandals? Philippe Flop. Man, you're a tough crowd. What do Alexander the Great and Winnie the Pooh have in common? Same middle name. Oh, come on. I'm trying to keep this kid friendly, you know. What did the mayonnaise say when the refrigerator door was opened? Close the door! I'm dressing! Seriously? How could you not like that one? Why is Peter Pan always flying? Because he never lands. Get it? Now that was funny! Did you not get it? Peter Pan never lands? Forget it. What does tofu and a dildo have in common? They're both meat substitutes. Thanks for watching, everyone.